Très bien. Bienvenue au Moudam pour le vernissage de l'exposition de Tacita Dean et pour l'entretien sur son travail avec un groupe qui est très intéressant. A very warm welcome to the opening of Tacita Dean and this conversation that will follow my very short and quick introduction. Moudam is very honored and proud to introduce this new exhibition by Tacita that you will be able to discover after this conversation in the galleries of the first floor of the Moudam. Tacita Dean exhibition is articulated around two recent projects. The trilogy of work that he created for the Dante Project, a ballet that was premiered at the Royal Opera House in October 2021, and for which he designed the sets and the costumes. When we look at our times of conflict, I think there's nothing better than talking about Dante's Inferno and leave it open for reflection. There's a second part to this show. It's a 16mm film, 150 years of painting. The film is a conversation between artist Julie Mehretu and Luchita Hurtado, and was shot in the apartment of the latter in the first days of 2000, a few months before she sadly passed away. Also, this is not only a story between two women, it's also the history, it shows the history and the stories of women artists in the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st century that makes it also very, very touching. And in the exhibition, and I'm very grateful for that, the film is accompanied by paintings by Julie Mehretu and Luchita Hurtado, bringing the works of the three artists into dialogue for the first time. And as Tacita said today, this will be, we are pretty sure that this will be the only situation of bringing all these three wonderful female artists together. But maybe there will be another side, but it is a unique situation. And you can also, you really should watch this film in full length in the gallery upstairs. And I also, today, now also the what is this called again? Thank you. It arrived today. We have this, we published this wonderful two publications, each publication for one part of the show. You can get it here. And it's really extremely well done. You're going to enjoy it. Now, we are very, very proud as well to have a unique conversation between three amazing artists, Tacita Dean, Julie Mehretu, and Matt Mullican, who presents his mother, the late Luchita Hurtado, tonight, moderated by art historian Briony Fer. Before I let you to enjoy this wonderful conversation, I would like to thank the people who conceived and made this exhibition happen. First and foremost, the wonderful artist, Tacita Dean. I thank her for her continuous involvement in the curatorial process, her generosity, and her outstanding artistic vision. Thank you very much, Tacita. I'm also very grateful to Julie Mehretu and to the estate of Luchita Hurtado, represented by Hurtado's son, John, and Matt Mullican, for kindly accepting to be part of this exhibition and also for lending us the beautiful two pieces in the exhibition. Then my special thanks goes to Susan Cotte, director of Moudam between 2018 and 2021, for initiating this exhibition in dialogue with the artists, and especially for coming here from Sydney, Australia. Thank you so much, Susan. Tacita Dean has been accompanied by a wonderful team, and especially Cleo Walker from his studio, and Ken Graham, who worked on the displays, as well as on the installation of the three projections. And then I would also like to thank the Moudam team. Christophe Dallois, he was the curator together with Suzanne on this exhibition, and Clémentine Probé, the assistant curator, and you're going to see later on the amazing job they both did. The registrar team, and especially Boris Relon, exhibition registrar, and Véronique Guerlazur, the head registrar, then the technician team around Thierry Gratien, then the publication team, Deborah Lambollet and Clarice Hartmann, the communication team, and especially Magali Weirich, Lawrence Schön, Julie Defoe, Ornella Duchesne, and Casey Till. The sponsorship and partnership team, especially Anna Ricourt and Marta Lavaroni. Tacita Dean was also assisted in the development of the exhibition design by François Thierry and Lorenzo Vellito of Polaris Architects from Luxembourg. And we would like to express our gratitude to the lenders of the works in the exhibition, without whom the exhibition would not have been possible. I would like to thank the Centre Pompidou, Musée National d'Art Moderne, Centre de Création Industrielle, the Hoffman Foundation, Board Editions, Gemini GL, and Hauser & Wirth. And I'm also thanking the galleries, representing the artists, First Street Gallery and Marion Goodman, for their real big support. Jane and Rose, thank you for being here tonight. The publication has been beautifully designed by Martin Ritzel, a long-time collaborator of Cassidus. And yes, we are thanking also the Verlag der Buchhandlung Walter und Franz König, who published the book. Last but not least, I'm very grateful to the authors of the book, Jennifer King, curator at large at LACMA, and Briony Fer. So, I would like, Briony Fer is doing the moderation tonight, and I would like you to introduce you to Briony before I hand over. Briony Fer, maybe you know her, she also did like a wonderful lecture for the show of Zoe Leonard. She is an art historian, a professor of history of art at UCA in London, and an author of numerous publications, such as On Abstract Art, The Infinite Line, a monograph on Eva Hesse and on Gabriel Orozco. Briony Fer wrote a wonderful essay on the Dante Project in the publication. We are very lucky to have her with us today to introduce and moderate this unique conversation. So I hand over to you, Briony. Have a fantastic evening afterwards, after you saw the show. We are meeting outside for also having drinks and a barbecue. And I would be really pleased if you stay and have a very good evening here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Bettina, and everybody here at Mudam for making this happen and allowing me to moderate this conversation. I feel honoured but mainly touched to be sitting alongside these three extraordinary artists. I did contribute to the catalogue for this show on the Dante Project, but I just want to say that Tacita's work has been for decades completely formative. I guess you could say that word's not even really good enough, but the kind of work that just informs everything that you do, in a sense, in not necessarily explicit or direct ways. So to be here and thinking about the work together is really extraordinary. We decided, as you said, Bettina, this is a unique event. It's a unique chance to show this work in this way upstairs, which I found it really remarkable and will be really interesting to think about with you. But also kind of this lineup on this platform is pretty amazing, and I imagine also quite unique. So to have not only Tacita here, but also Matt Mullican and Julie Mehretu, we decided that rather than talk about all aspects of the show, we should really use this time to think about 150 years of painting. And just to perhaps expand from that as and when, but to really just try to create the conditions for a conversation that I hope that all of you can think about further and continue when you have the chance to look at the work. And it seems to me that this particular work, and these are three key protagonists, sadly Luchita Hurtado died and her representation on earth is now on this platform, is Matt. And I think it's interesting to think about what that film is. In one sense, it seemed to be a film portrait, or it's an incredible conversation between you, Julie, and Luchita, who's this extraordinary force of nature. Matt is in the film, and also Tacita, the film is part of that. Is the interlocutor. So I think it's kind of interesting to think of it not just being of this conversation, but how the film is a part of that. But I understand that it happened on one day. So perhaps you could start by just kick off by what that means to have made that, filmed that in one day.
It was January the 3rd. 2020, and it was Julie's parents' wedding anniversary as well. So it was already a providential day, and we were in Santa Monica, in this beautiful apartment of Luchita, and we scrambled this whole thing together very, very quickly. I was in L.A., Julie was coming to L.A., and Matt was doing a print project in San Francisco, and you said you would come via L.A., do you remember? And to be with Luchita, because of the underpinning coincidence of the whole project is that Julie and Luchita were both born, on November the 28th. And I knew this, because I've known Julie for years, and I knew it from Matt after a certain point, and then I suddenly realized that Julie was going to be 50 and Luchita was going to be 100 in 2020. And it's just the coincidence of that day that made me make the film, because I'm such a stickler for that sort of thing. My life is dominated by coincidence. And I just thought, I was with my family in our condominium in LA, and I was thinking, I have to make a film, and I have to call it 150 Years of Painting. And then I asked Julie, and she was game, and then I asked Matt, and then Luchita, and they both up for it, and it was just, it was because it came about so spontaneously, that spontaneity carried into the day a bit, didn't it? And it was a very, very special day, and we did film in one day, and initially that we thought that, but time, diurnal time is not important. Of course, there is shift in light, but that it was always going to be just this, time out of time, in a way. So, normally and often with my films, I'm very conscious of shifts of light, liminal light, often light fades and then, the film inevitably ends because the day ends and I fade to black, and and Julie said she'd do it on the condition that there was no fade to black, and I understood that, so the challenge was for me to make it a continuous loop, that it would just be, and the way the whole day turned out was that there was this circling and this continual looping was so prominent anyway within the conversation. But that was my labor later, was to cut it and honor that spirit.
Julie, you were there in that moment, and it's kind of incredible to watch you. You know, you have a real sense of the conversation being in the making as we're watching it. It's that sense of kind of incompleteness, I suppose, that you don't quite know where it's going, and you're navigating it as we go, and I wondered what that felt like, but how you look back on it as well after it's come into the world, I guess, edited and shortened and...
Thank God that it's edited. I think what makes it work so well. At first, I just want to say it was an immense honor. It is an immense honor to have been a part of the film and to have been a part of that day and to have been able to have the conversation with Luchita in that way. We've visited with her before all together. I know you have many times, but I had we had celebrated Oscars or something.
No, it wasn't the Oscars. Golden Globes.
Golden Globes with Ethiopian food with her.
Exactly.
And that was an amazing evening. And I was so moved by her whole... her whole apartment, her whole collection, her whole way of being, and photographs of her when she was young, and there were all these elements of her story, and it was so inspiring to me, and to all of us, I think, and so moving, and so for me to have the opportunity to just be a part of that was, but there was, I felt at the beginning there was a certain type of like desire to get a certain kind of conversation to happen, and in the end, it was just really about learning from her and trying to she was so profound in her answers and the way that she seemed to kind of engage with work was not from this place that I have been taught to engage with work, or I have engaged with work in many ways, or at least talking about making. It was really this place of, you know, the world and the way the world exists and her existence within that, and the sin of a butterfly, of killing a butterfly, and these types of that were formative to her making and how she engaged with making. And that was so incredible. I felt like I learned so much that day, and so I'm so enormously grateful, but also...
No, well, I am. I mean, we have to get past this stage.
Okay, but no,
I really am so grateful to you.
But it was really a moving day.
Not many people could pull that off, and, you know, and Matt was so important. You were the cement of the day, even though you were mostly cutting room floor.
Yeah.
And I hope you forgive me for that. But you had to be. You understand that. You were there, and that beautiful moment when it triangulates in the film is really, really important. You know, when she says, "You my son," and then that's where... I mean, I was very conscious of editing that in a way that was very, very...
in a way, I was the anchor for her. Being how important I was to her, at, you know, doing this, having experienced my entire life with her, so of course that was important for her. Yes, Matt, you remember that, and then I wasn't expecting to be on the movie at all. I was just going to be on the side there, and I was just wanted to watch it all.
But you were very important, I think, and especially in that moment about the coincidence. You know, about how you're both making, using the same materials.
Same materials.
Yeah.
Yes. And that goes back, you know, 45 years that we do this.
Mm.
And back and forth. Always backing, always asking her. And she was came to all my shows. I've had many, many shows. And my parents were always there. And they were always supportive. She was wonderful, I mean, that way. And always talking about the world in general as it applied to the work. You know, I was talking to someone, a younger artist, and she wanted to know, you know, how did she do this? How did she lived her life, and then at the age of 94, she becomes a phenomenon. Now, how do you do that? How do you get there? What happens when that... And honestly, it didn't matter. I think that's part of it, because it didn't change her at all. She was always who she was. I mean, my whole life, she was always this woman who entered a room and, you know, everybody was just in awe of her. I went with my mother. We went to an exhibition at Leo Castelli in Soho. And we walked in and, you know, and she knew Leo in the 40s. And then I knew people who worked at the gallery, and they told me that after we left, Leo Castelli said that she was the most beautiful woman in New York City in 1940, you know, six. I mean, the most beautiful, the it woman. And yet, at the same time as being having this tremendous charisma, people didn't see her as an artist. She was, you know, they looked through her. They didn't, they saw my father. He was the artist, she was the wife. Mm-hmm. And so, but this allowed her to make her work in a way. So she never really was trying to make it. She was never trying to become, you know, an important person. She was just making the best work she could make and making the work that resonates with it, with her. That was the point. Everything else was like, it came with it.
There's a wonderful, she says so many beautiful things in the film, and I can't remember the exact quote, of course, but it's something like, I didn't do it to be recognized. And in one sense, that's a statement of fact. She wasn't recognized. But it's almost a statement of an assertion that this is a more important, it's a life of making art. You know, the being recognized or not being recognized was slightly secondary for that. And it struck me that all of you, including Luchita, you know, what's at stake is a life of making art and how you navigate that and what that means in relation to your everyday life, what that means in relation to a politics, and that comes through the conversation in such a lot of both direct and indirect ways. And your life, in a way, Julie, the interweaving of the two narratives, you know, the stories of migration in a way, your mother from Venezuela, you from Addis Ababa, this sense of coincidence, but also the interweaving of these two narratives of a life with, strangely, quite a lot in common in some ways, kind of resonances.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, and, you know, I was thinking about what you said, too, about her being a woman and painting, and no one saw her as a painter and an artist. And she says that in the film. What was the quote exactly? She says something like, they never see you. Or, like, none of the husbands or something, right? Like, none of the men, they don't see you. And I think she became very comfortable with that, it felt, early in.
But you asked, you said, you know, did, and this is, a, you know, did Lee pay attention to,
yes.
He didn't pay attention to all that. And then you asked this absolutely brilliant thing. But you paid attention to all that with him, you know.
Okay, but something like that.
Yeah, and but that, you know, yes, he goes, yes, yes, you know, and that was the point, you know.
But that was the whole, what's so wonderful, even about the title, is that was the whole condition in which women artists were trying to paint, and been painting and making for decades. And many who are excluded from a conversation in abstraction or within making certain forms of work. And so there was something really potent at that moment where she says that and claims that. But the reason I thought about that was that the kind of what you talked about with this, you know, the narrative of, or the history of migration and the kind of making of who she is, how she comes to the United States and her childhood or being a young person here and then going back to Mexico, correct?
No, she came from Venezuela and she moved.
But she went back to Mexico?
She went to Mexico, but with Wolfgang Pollan.
Yes, that's right. And she talks about that. And I don't know if it's in the film. She talks about that and then coming back. And these various experiences, how she has to claim herself over and over and over, even in the context of her mother, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the kind of power in that, but the power in her knowledge of her life being one of many. Like, that this is not her first life, this is a form of experience, and it would be great if you told the story you mentioned to us earlier about how she said goodbye to you.
Oh, this is just, typical for her, in a sense. I mean, this must have been, she died on August 13th, and this must have been on August 5th or 6th or 7th or something like that. And we were talking, and she said, well, I've got to go now. And I said, what do you mean you have to go now? And she said, yeah, I have to go. and then we hung up, and that was basically the last time I talked to her. And but she said it half knowing that this was it, and really, it was just the oddest thing. And it wasn't like, oh my God, I didn't hear her say it. I heard exactly what she told me, and I heard in saying it, like, you know, like the title of that show was "I Will Be Reborn," yeah. And that is who she is. She had total faith. She wasn't going, and she'd always been in, and she's still in me. That's very clear. Mm-hmm. People ask, well, how did your mother influence you? Well, of course, she did influence me as a role model, as a person who sees the world in a particular way, and I got it. I got that for sure. And we have crossed back and forth in our work my whole life. And so that was really a big part of that. And so it was just odd. Like, well, gotta go.
When you watched the film, Matt, did you learn anything about your mother that you hadn't known? Or was there something in
maybe a few stories? But mm-hmm. No, this woman is a force, was a force. And I got that. I got that it just was happening. And that's what I got from it. I mean, just going upstairs when I arrived here and just not even going, just seeing the painting and then hearing her voice in the next room. This is creepy, okay? I'm going to see a beautiful show of Tacita's. Beautiful show. And then I go and I see my mother's painting. A beautiful, great painting that Tacita somehow convinced the powers that be to get here for this show, which was a genius thing to do. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden I hear, oh my God, my mom. And then I go in there and it's the voice. It's the voice as much as anything. That voice I will never, ever, ever, ever forget, ever. And because it, within that voice is my world. My entire world is there in that voice. I mean, and when she died, it was not tragic for me. I mean, how could it be? She died at the age of 99, and she had, at the end of her life, this miracle happen. I mean, for us, because these kind of things count, but for her, it really didn't count. That's why it could happen to her. She didn't really, it didn't mean that much to her. She loved the you know, going, can you imagine, you're invited to, she worked with Hauser and Wirth, shamed me, I mean, in terms of like gallery, my whole life I was going from gallery to gallery, and then she just, you know, at the age of nine, she goes to one of the most powerful galleries in the world, and so she goes there to have lunch, and she, as far as she understood, so she's going into the gallery, and there was a huge banquet. She had no idea. And when she walked in, everybody stood up and started applauding. And she just, what was she supposed to do? Well, she just, she became the queen. She just walked in. Everybody ran up to her, and you were the greatest, da-da-da-da-da-da. But she was like that my whole life. Of course, she didn't have the crowds, but she was already there. She was there when I remember. I have stories from when I was five, and you had the same quality. She had that. And it really, and part of it was that she had this big picture of life and the world. And that's what came back, that's what really comes at the end of her life, was the fact that we are in, and I should say, effing trouble. And that was the biggest thing, that was the only thing on her, was ecology. That was it. The earth. The earth, the earth, the earth, the earth. This became primal, 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 primal. You couldn't see her without her going into some kind of big thing about it. And that ran her at the end. That's all she wanted, was to get that message across. That kept her going.
That is really powerful, in that sense of the planet. That sense of, I mean, there's something about friendship. I mean, there's a lot of friendship on this panel here, but also that sense of love and friendship seems, love rather than only friendship seems to be so present, including, although it might sound a bit cliched, this sense of a life-enhancing force that is affirmative, and that sense of her perspective from that point in her life, that she's able to say these quite extraordinary things that resonate so profoundly. But it's also, I wondered about, I mean, it's so much your film, Tacita, her hands, because I think we all know exactly what our mother's hands look like, yeah. You know, and you recognize it in your own, don't you, as you get older, these things, and the hands really figure around your hands as well in this film. So there's something so very spiritual, there's a real sense of spirituality and a journey through life, but it's so about a tangible world that we touch, and that's so much the world that you let us see in that, well, the film, you do that. I wondered if you could say a little about that.
Well, on a practical level, I mean, I've always been very, very, you know, I've always filmed the details of it. I mean, I'm attracted to details. On a practical level, for a film like 150 Years of Painting, you know, if you film the hands, you don't have to worry about the things, the lips, so like, you know, in a way that it's quite useful to film that. And, you know, and I could always go there in order to get to another place. You know, and also we, you know, there are all these practical things. You know, we had two cameras on this, but one of the cameras went down, which made it much more difficult to make it continuous because, of course, it is film. And film runs out. And every 10 minutes, the film has run out. You carry on talking. We have to change the film. I come back, totally different thing going on. And we carry on filming. But when it comes to editing, I'm thinking, okay, there. And then I've got this. And there's a whole bit in the middle, which I don't have. So I have to do, and I, you know, I feel really artisanal when I cut my film. I use my hands. I'm cutting, I'm literally cutting, rewind. I mean, it's really physical. And my job, and I really see it as the most, this is when I'm an artist the most, actually, is when I'm alone cutting this film, and I have to get from there to there, and how do I do it? And it's not easy. And I, you know, cutaways, as I call them, hands, but also little, you know, tiny little surgical cuts in the length taken to say something might be enough to get to there and then get to... I mean, it is so laboured, but that's when I'm an artisan, actually. You know, that's when I feel like I'm really an artist. So...
You don't feel that labour at all.
No, but isn't that the point?
Yeah, always.
Isn't it best to, you know, I always say this quite often, but I interviewed Leo Steinberg, the art historian. I went to photograph his hands, and again, as it happened, I've obviously got a hand thing, but, and I just read The Line of Fate, his text on this beautiful essay on the plane, and I'm, you know, I don't read a lot of theory, but I read this and it was so easy to read. And I remember saying, this was just so easy to read. And he said, well, there's an enormous amount of labour in trying to make something appear easy. And I think that's one of the, you know, most important things is to appear something that, like, even the Gemini prints, I mean, they're so laboured, yet they look so simple. Mm. And I, you know, yes, I need to persuade you that it's just happening in time. You know, and that's my job, you know, that's what, you know, that's the power of editing, and that's the importance of editing, and artifice that comes from editing, and the absolutely fundamental difference between film and digital, because film makes you do that, whereas digital, we could just, I mean, that camera's just watching us, you know, they don't edit at all, they just watch. You know, there's no, you know, and therefore, you know, with the labour comes the miracle. Do you know what I mean? With the change, you know. So, but Matt, do you remember when I asked you, is there anything you learnt from the film for the first time? Do you remember what you told me?
No.
You said it was, and it was with Val and the kid, you know, and We were in New York, and you said it was mascara when she said that, you know, it's from the grave.
Yeah, that's true. She said that. And I don't think, I think that's now. I think that's in the last, you know, she made that picture for almost 50 years ago. So lots have happened since.
Yeah, yeah.
Because in looking at mascara, this painting, you have the edge of the painting, there are four mountains. And of course, being in the ground, you would be surrounded by soil. But it's the condition of life on this earth is that those mountains are there. Wherever you are looking up, there is a horizon around you.
But there's something, I think she might have really meant it actually.
Yes.
Because there's something about that painting.
Yes.
Where you said that.
And there's
you
a cross right there.
Yeah, but you feel it.
Yes.
And don't forget Pablo's death and all this is going on. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's not like, and if you think this the whole time. And
yeah.
There's a lot about death in the film.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, you know, I always say I'm not afraid of death, but of course I'm afraid of death. I can smell I'm afraid of death.
Mm-hmm.
I smell it on me.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot about the senses. Mm-hmm. You know, when you ask her that beautiful question about why did you become an artist, and she said, it's because of the smell of butterflies. Do you remember?
Yeah.
That's just like, whoa. Mm-hmm. Where did that, you know? Yeah, I
can smell a butterfly. Can smell a butterfly. And then that's what she told us about how she would pin them.
Yeah, but it was just such an answer that was just, I mean, do you remember we just thought, that's just the most amazing, I mean, there were so many amazing answers that she gave, and there were life answers for me in that room, as well as all of us in the room. And also another one is about, you know, you said, does it get better? You know, she gets, you know, you about you being exactly half her age, and then saying, you know, how is it? And she goes, oh, it gets better. And, you know, and you know, you're saying, oh, that was great. You know, and she goes then about fear and, you know, because we, as mothers, you live always with the fear that something will happen to your children. And but because she had been through that, she said, I am not fearful. And that was really strong, too. I am not fearful. And she talked a lot about the death of her son, Pablo, to polio. And I mean, at a time, this, you know, I remember when I was cutting it, it was the height of the pandemic and people were refusing to be vaccinated. And you thought, listen to Lucita. Mm-hmm. I mean, that story alone, you know, the polio vaccinations have saved so many people's lives. Why, you know, what? And I was, you know, it was just such a beautiful thing. Listen to the film, just watch the film and understand why science has prevented many people from going through what Luchita went. I remember, because that was always what I, you know, I was editing that during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. So.
You know, when after Pablo died, she went blind for, I think, a week or two. Literally, she could not see. The trauma was so great. And it was just a huge thing.
I remember her mentioning that.
But did she mention that?
She mentioned that.
Yeah.
She didn't mention it on film.
In that white area in the middle.
That was between changes.
But it was also amazing is that she continued to paint through everything and continued to, that this was a lifeline in a way.
Mm.
Like, that making was so much a way of understanding and kind of and finding something else. Like, to me, that was also something that came across really profoundly while we were there.
Yeah. I mean, the whole, I wondered if you might have any reflections on the way that film maybe relates or touches on other works in the show, because it maybe forced itself on me, but this sense of a spiritual journey or navigating a life as an artist or a poet is Dante's Divine Comedy. What else is that except the navigation of heaven and hell? And, you know, that sense of, and this 150 years of painting in some ways through this relationship to painting, which in both of you is so powerful, as you're pouring, you know, over those images in the film that are there, and we can see them in this anteroom. you know, there is this sense of what it means to navigate a life. And I just, I'm now kind of totally overwhelmed by the correlations or in a way coincidental correspondences which I keep finding in the two sides of the exhibition. Maybe exaggerated in my imagination because when they first hit you, but Matt, you have some...
You
really
said something beautiful to me earlier today.
Well, just the three film works and the two sides, because of the Paradise film, I was in there, and that for me was about the feeling of the mind, you know, the feeling of consciousness, not conscious, but the feeling of it. So, and that's in the relationship to Paradise and to heaven, which is how I see it in my own work. And then from there we go to my mother, which is the artist, and the artist with all of the ups and the downs, and the fact that we have bodies of blood and bone, and you cannot deny that, and you know, the butterfly and the whole thing. And then the last film that I saw was the Giotto surface.
The fresco, which is a series of details,
which is amazing. Mm. I mean, this is just an extraordinary picture, because that's the surface. That's the picture. And so you have the mind, you have the artist, the arm, and you have the material. And it's these three things, which is really, as an artist, these are big issues. and they communicate. And they're not, and they go beyond any kind of particular issue. It's really about just life, the way my mother would talk about it. And then you have the other works as well. But just those three kind of designate the show in these three different ways. Mm. And it was really just to be in that Giotto room was amazing, especially because the two ends are abstract. In the middle, you have my mom. You know, which is us. That's how we you know, as we see faces, as we see people, we experience the world through others. And we identify with others, and that was my mother. That's what she does in the show. She becomes that person.
Yeah. But also, I think I think that's really beautiful about the film and the mind and consciousness, like the experience of that. But one thing that's so interesting is this show feels like it's all about painting, like every aspect of it. The film itself, in terms of its abstraction and color and the light and how Tacita works with the masks or whatever, the magic he did that you won't describe. But the way that film comes together is really like, it feels like it's painting to me. And then the Giotto as well. But what also I just want to say is that majority of this work was made during pandemic, correct? It was made during this period of time where Tess said, I'm not doing anything. How are you painting? I'm not doing anything. I'm not doing this. So much, like this entire, you know, most of the work except for the Giotto piece, right? And it feels like, I mean, some of the Gemini stuff you had done before, but a lot of that was being, the colors was being printed through. So anyway, the other thing is so much is made by your hand in this show, and while photography and film are big kind of a background or backbone to all of that, it's really made by hand. The film is made by hand, and the abstraction and the kind of ways of thinking through space and all of that. And so to me, the veracity and the kind of intensity and tenacity with which Tacita makes is again talking about a life force or a line through a life. I don't know anyone who works and continuously is making and pushing new forms like the way you are. So that to me is an amazing kind of thread that you see in the show. And every time you go to see one of these exhibitions, I have felt always amazed by the kind of breadth of the show and the kind of, whether you go to the little clovers, to the enormous blackboards, to these trees that are just a miracle, to these films which are really take so much, but the kind of conceptual, I know you talk about it as being serendipitous or kind of around coincidence and chance, but there's usually this other conceptual branch that is the bridge into that. And I was looking at the Jacaranda piece today, and just the reversal of that, and the painting that they're painted, right? They're painted or drawn.
Colored painting.
Like painting, drawing.
Yeah.
Big drawing.
Yeah.
Small little tree painting, big tree drawing.
Yeah, the graphic touch.
I just wanted to bring that up as another form, another line, and it's this insistence on a form of being here, but of making and being an artist, and the kind of like, you know, that to me is really moving every time, and I think that that's something that's in that film as well, like that Luchita's insistence on making.
Well, it's like going to see the concert. The dance performance in London. I went with my daughter, who actually worked, helped Tacita with one of the trees, and so we all went to celebrate
the tree.
That was the tree.
The one that was on stage.
And we go there, and okay, and then we enter this world that is unbelievable. That opera house or whatever, that dance concert, what was the Royal Opera House.
The
Royal Opera House. Here we're going into the Royal Opera House. But I mean, it's just outrageous, the context that you're kind of you're right there in the middle of it.
Mm-hmm.
That's so far away from, you know,
where
we are.
Right.
You really put yourself out there. And I remember when you did that piece with that actor, who had the, what's it called?
Stephen Delane.
Yeah, but he had...
Event for stage.
I know, but yeah, event for stage, but what is it when an actor doesn't remember their line?
Yeah, yeah.
What was it called?
Stage fright.
No. There's it's called...
Drying.
A dry. Is it a dry or a
dry?
You know, and the way you talked about that with me, I mean, because you are putting yourself at risk when you're doing that. You put your own self at risk of drying.
By
putting yourself into such an uncomfortable, far away situation, and this is something you do. This is how you're fearless. I mean, fearless to do all this stuff.
I'm not sure.
No, you are. Because you might be scared, but you're very strong at the same time. You can handle it. Of course you can.
For you to put the work in this show together, I mean, were there things that surprised you when it came into being in these kind of conjunctions of work?
Well, I mean, I do see the connective threads and things that, you know, surprise me sometimes as well. Sometimes they're conscious. Like there's a little slate drawing that's called "Smoke Your" or something. Your skin coat, smoke your skin coat, and I was literally thinking of Luchita, so I looked up "smoke" in my concordance, and of Shakespeare, and that little drawing was I was really thinking about her. And that's why it's got after LH written on it. So that's a very obvious thing. But then the April the 26th. Is my father's birthday and also the birthday of a friend's father, and they're both judges. They were both judges. So I wrote the judges on it. But of course, there's this moment in the film, she goes, that's the judges. And she's pointing to this painting. And you say, is that... And I've never worked out what you said. and I think it might be Manana. I'm not sure. Menina and Manana, you know, the two... No.
The two nurses,
the women
who looked after her.
The aunt, the maiden aunt.
Oh, yeah.
She goes, Manina, Manana, and then you say that Manana, and you know, but you say it in a way that I still to this day don't know what you're saying. And, but she was saying, and that, you know, it's for that, the judges, but then I looked at it, and it's called Untitled in the book, because I needed to check, and I was like, okay, it's Untitled, but it's the judges. And it's these characters, these dark characters, that sort of like in sitting in judgment. You don't know anything about that painting. No, but then yesterday I was looking at the judges and I thought, oh my God, the judges. So it was just a, you know, I mean, I know that's a small thing, but it's just like, it's not like judgment. I've lived without judgment in my life. You know, absolutely. But yes, I mean, Paradise, this is the first time it's ever shown here as a autonomous work of art, which Thomas Adès let me use the, you know, what's called a MIDI, is a computer-generated soundtrack. And I go in there, I find that immensely moving, even though it's the music for me. I mean, obviously, I made the visuals, but it's just that film, just partly because of the memory of the Royal Opera House and the memory of, and then Alex, I don't know if he's here, but he projected it every night, and the tension of showing 35mm in the Royal Opera House, I can't tell you, I was in a sort of fetal ball of agony. Because, you know, if that film went down then, I mean, there's no worse place to fail. And is he, Alex, you here? Where are you? This guy, he was practically in boxer shorts because it was so hot in there. And stuff like that, and every night you pulled it off, and even when I wasn't there, I'd be texting saying, is it perfect? And then the last night I was in Rome, and they sent us a live link, and Cleo and I and Ken, we went and watched it in the hotel room, and still, I mean, it was just like the tension that I had in paradise. And so it was so nice to just go in there and just think, but it all came back, you know, that sort of like. Because, you know, live art, I'm not used to, I mean, although I make films and people are used to them breaking down, and the amount of times I've gone in to see my exhibitions and it just goes out of order. But there's something much worse about, you know, an entire ballet, you know, seeing all that, and then the film goes, I lived in fear of that moment, you have no idea. And now it's so popular, I'm going to have to go through it all again, because it's going to be in Paris next year in May, and then it's going back to London, and then it's going to Copenhagen, and now they're talking about, and I'm just thinking, my whole life is ruined. I'm going to have to let go of this one, because of course everyone else can just walk away from productions. I mean, they're all a bit, I don't know if anyone works with theatre people, but they're always like, okay, next one. Yeah, next one. But I mean, for me, I can't, because I've got to be, and Alex is, you know, committed the rest of his life. I hope you realise that. And then the other thing is, like, you know, the soles are sprayed in chalk, which is the same material that I use for the plates. It's also the same way I made the lithograph. It's become obsolete. You know, they discontinued it. It's just like I lived my whole life with obsolescence.
Has it ever occurred to you that you should stay away from certain the kids of Tacita, the media?
Well, no shade to black. I know. Yeah.
Just keep away next time you really want to keep using the material, but
pencil.
Do you think we've got time for any questions, very briefly? If any of the audience wants to address. No? I think in a way perhaps that's rather. That anticipates too much. You need to go and see the exhibition, and also be able to see the ballet. In fact, the Dante Project as it's performed in all these different places. So we think that's absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, Paris, not so far from Luxembourg.
Yeah.
But the thing that was so remarkable in going to the Royal
Opera House.
Big Opera House thing. Was that at the end, we were all crying. Everybody in the audience was just crying. And about this Bali thing that's going on, we have here, they're all crying, just looking at this totally abstract thing. So we're obviously connecting to something, but it's not literal, it's abstract. And it connected so thoroughly with us, which is really the part of art that is a mystery. How, when something actually hits you hard, you have no idea why, but you accept it and you go through it, because that was all we wanted to do was to find Tacita. We knew she was in the building, and we had gone to London from Berlin. And we wanted to hug her. We wanted to hug Tacita because it was just brilliant. And my daughter was there, and Valerie was my wife, and it was just. Such a cathartic, kind of incredible.
You know, one of the last photos that I have of Luchita is taken by Lucy with the tree. They went to the actual one that was. And there's a photo of Luchita and Lucy, and Luchita's that's got an getting oxygen at that point, so
oh.
It was quite late on. But they went on a pilgrimage to find the tree, and it was in jacaranda time, because it was jacaranda time, so it would have been May, June.
Perfect.
Wow. So that was one of the last pictures probably was the last picture I had.
Probably the last picture.
But they went,
yeah.
So it is connected. And actually, there's another connection, quickly, which we'll just... is that Luchita and Noguchi were really, really old friends. And Yanbo has got Noguchi installation here. And so they were, you know, absolutely close friends, weren't they? And you said you should talk about a bit about him.
Noguchi was like a godfather. I mean, whenever he was in Los Angeles, he would come to us. We'd all meet up. And the most elegant man. Oh, my God. This guy, Issey Miyake, did all his shirts. I mean, just for him, this is church for him. And he was extraordinary, and I grew up with him. I mean, he was around my life before I could remember. And so that was part of being in Mom's world, was that, Henry Miller, Anais Nin, you had Christopher Isherwood live next door. You had, there was somebody who was moving to Los Angeles to have me, and because she was, this is typical for my mom was desperate to have a child. She lost her second child, Pablo, and she wanted to have me. And she was married to an Austrian surrealist named Wolfgang Pauling, and he was a count, and was like, and so his brother committed suicide. He eventually did commit suicide. And so madness, and he just didn't want to have kids. No way was he going to have kids. So my father, my mother, and Pauling all lived in the same house in Mill Valley above San Francisco. And so my father and my mother fell in love. They had me. And she had to leave, of course, at this point. And she moved to Los Angeles. And so the guy said, a friend of ours, Giles Healy, who was actually the person who discovered, those giant heads in the jungle
mm-hmm.
in Mexico?
Mm-hmm.
He's the discoverer of those heads, this guy.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and he was a remarkable Giles Healy, incredible guy. But in any case, so she goes there and he says, I can introduce you to anybody in LA you want to be introduced to. So she said, James Agee. She wanted to meet James Agee. And so, she met James Agee, and Mia Agee, James Agee's wife, became best friends. And in fact, when I moved to New York, I stayed at Mia's house the first year I was there. And the second person was Charlie Chaplin. So she got to know Charlie Chaplin. And he offered to help paint her house when she moved into this little house, in the canyon. And then the third person was Iris Tree, who had an apartment in the Santa Monica merry-go-round. Above the merry-go-round on Santa Monica Pier, and who she had known and who she wanted to meet again. So, and then, someone like Man Ray took her picture when they were married. So we have this beautiful photograph of my mom by Man Ray. And it's just a charmed life. It was just extraordinary. I have so many interviews, and I would just ask, who did she know? He met everyone from Greta Garbo to Stravinsky to, it was a small world back then. This was in Los Angeles in the 40s. It was insane.
Mm.
And she has that in her. It means that, and she did. She just had that in her.
Do you remember her painting?
Yes. She used to paint on our porch. In the 40s, in the 50s, she painted on our porch, those crayon resist pieces. And that ended up being my room. I ended up being in that room. It was a tiny little house. And then she got, she started painting when we were in Chile. We lived in South America for a year. And she started doing the self-portraits, painting the ground with her body.
Mm.
She would paint her feet. She would paint the ground she stood on. So you see her feet, you see her breast, you see her stomach, and you see the top of her leg. And you do not see, and her stomach, I think, was the most important part, and the breast, of course. The stomach and the breast were very, very important. And so that's what she did. And so you have two people on in the painting, and you are both of them. You, as the viewer, are in the head of both people. You're at the head of all the people because the head is missing. Your head becomes their head. So you become all of them, looking down at the earth. And then the next series he did was looking up, and you have the mountains around you. So you're looking up at the sky. And then what do you see in the sky? You see the feathers. You see, you know, that whole thing happening. So it's from looking at yourself on the ground. She took photographs of her shadow. So many photographs of her shadows, again and again and again, all about her physical body, her physical form. She was fascinated by the fact that she was alive and that she had a body and that she lived in this world and she had, you know, this is part of, and that's what she gave me, you know, because that's all about, my work is all about that, about living in this world and how weird it is, you know.
But that comes across so powerfully in the work, I think, of all of you, in fact, and also that sense of different histories and different temporalities getting kind of scrambled. So the way she seems to span the whole of the virtually 20th century culture,
and
yet she's totally in that moment in your film.
Yeah.
She's totally there. She's totally, she wants to be here, she says. You know, that sense of being in this life now, you know, is kind of really very
completely vital. Utterly vital.
And at the very end, towards the last 2 or 3 years of her life, it just became so outrageous what was happening that she became, you know, Time Magazine's 100 most influential people on the planet. I mean, that was Time Magazine. So there were only two artists in the magazine. It was David Hockney and my mom. Now, how do you get there? How did she get that? How did this happen? What is this about? She did know, she had already met Greta Garbo, so, you know, not so far away.
But also, when you mention the feathers, and then she has different elements of different kinds of cloth, different blankets, and most of this is kind of, there are signs of indigeneity in this particular way, and very powerful. Like, I've learned since that those, I think, are eagle feathers, and maybe hawk feathers, but the hawk feather has a kind of like other thing, but because of another artist that I'm in conversation with a lot right now, I see that there's this real kind of potency to those feathers particularly, and so there are these signs that we might even be a little illegible too, you know, and she has this, there's this power of this, there's something else that she's kind of tapping into, and you mentioned that this kind of spiritual kind of dynamic happening in the film, but I really feel like there's this constant kind of place of inspiration for her that is coming from these other senses. I mean, she says, like, I smell the butterfly. And those signs are in those paintings, in the clouds, in the shapes of the clouds, in the shading of the mountains, what we were talking about earlier, and the kind of layering of the feathers becoming a cross. And the directionality of the feathers.
Well, the feathers
each
are all
one.
Going one direction except for the one going across. And the one that's facing up is actually has a shadow on that hill, but there are hills all the way around. So why would the shadow be there and not up above? But it's really a kind of a curious up, down, left, right kind of thing going.
And then also I think I remember with the blankets, with those kind of Navajo blankets, there's also this play about space and directionality and you know, not just in terms of the geometry, but in terms of how that operates within the body and the land. So there's all these kind of, you know, they're pretty complex in those ways as well.
Tacita, would you like the last word?
I don't need the last word. I think, you know, I think Luchita has the last word in a way, because in the film, you know, what is it? It's just so beautiful. I think I found out. about, you know, who she was. It was so beautiful, I think. Or something like that. It's very, very beautiful. And I think that's the really... And about, and that the exuberance about being, I like it here. And you say, I like it here too. And I'm thinking, well, I like it here too. you know, so it's, you know...
Yes to life.
That's exactly what she says. And we all have to... Despite everything that's going on, we have to really say yes to life.
Okay, well, I'm under strict instructions. We've already pushed it, our time limit. So I guess I just want to thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Briony.
That was really wonderful to hear you speaking, but also I feel that everybody, all of us, can go into the show with such a kind of suggestive set of, like, amazing set of references and things to think about as we go and look at the work. So thank you, and thank you, all of you.
Thank you.